Good morning, good morning. It's good to see everybody out. This cool, Lord, that cooler, it's what happens when this time of year comes around, but it's still just a beautiful day. When you come out to the end of our driveway, there's a little holler right in front of us. And for years and years, it's always showed up. There is one really bright red maple tree. It's kind of like the, all right, I'm here. So I noticed this morning it was just as bright as could be. So it's that time of year. I know a lot of people are saying they don't want to be too far south because they don't have all the seasons, and they don't want to go too far north to get all the seasons. It's kind of like we're just like Goldilocks. We're just right. So it's good to see everybody here today. For announcements this morning, first of all, we've got a couple cards that I'd like to share with us. We had a special day last week honoring Dale Nichols and Don Leonard for Elder Emeritus. Madeline, I would like to thank you for honoring us last Sunday. It was a very humbling experience for us. The bell is a special memento, remembering the many times the church has rang to announce services. God bless you all. And that was from Dale and Madeline, and this is from Dale. It says, thank you. Doesn't seem to seem sufficient for the beautiful and thoughtful day of celebration. We're beyond appreciation for the gifts, compliments, and prayers. We thank God. We thank God we're able to serve him through this wonderful congregation. The bell and flowers were beautiful. We will be able to enjoy this bell and pass it on to the next generation. Thank you very much. Yeah, we'll have to. I hope the ones that is here got a chance to go up. That is a bell that will be here a while. That was probably what, 40, 45, 50 pound bells. So they were, yeah. And they do ring right well. It was a good day, and we're very thankful for that good day. As far as our prayer request, one of the things that we're wanting to do in this coming week, you'll be getting a email or a letter wanting us to have a day of prayer for the special needs that's going on around our world, especially in Israel. And we want to ask the Lord to just provide peace of some sort. It is a lot of death and destruction that's going on. And also, there's a lot of things that's in the States, a lot of things in our lives that's going on. We're just, as we shared with us, we need to have a special day of prayer. So you'll be getting more information on that this week also. Also, we want to pray for Sil Avon. She was at her granddaughter's wedding, and she was dancing with her grandson and had a fall. And so they've had her checked out. She was in the hospital, and they released her. She's got one more test that they will do this week, but so far all the tests are coming back positive. So let's continue to pray for Sil Avon's. Are there any other prayer requests that we can mention today?
My sister Isabel is back in the hospital.
Okay. So you may remember her. Let's continue to remember Madeline's sister Isabel Parker. She's back in the hospital. Anybody else?
I just remembered Jimmy Barhead asked that we pray for his brother Dan. He has been in and out of the hospital a tremendous amount recently with heart issues, infections, and he's just really tough for us, so we can pray for Dan Barr.
Okay, Jim Barr, our second pastor, Kyle Barr, this would be his son. We asked to pray for Dan Barr, who has been in and out of the hospital recently. I think they're in what, Massachusetts?
They moved to
Chattanooga. Okay, all right. Okay, so thank you, Madeline. So let's be in prayer for Dan Barr. Any others? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Lord, we thank you for this day. This is a day that you've made, and we rejoice and we are glad in it. But we know that as we come before you, there's just so many things going on in our minds, so many things that we're thinking of that can be a distraction. So we ask, Lord, that you would just do that work in our lives that calms us. Lord, that can cause us to want to draw near to you. We ask, Lord, that this morning you will be praised. You will be uplifted. We pray, Lord, that you will be with Andy as he's on vacation, that you will give him this time of rest this week. And we pray that you will guard and guide him and this family. Lord, we ask that this morning, as we've assembled here, there's many of our friends that have special needs. We ask that we would lift them up. We do think of Seal Avon. We think of Isabel Parker and Dan Barr. And there's many others. Lord, as we sit here, we ask that we would look around. And we would look at those near us and pray for those and the needs that they have. We thank you, Lord, for this day. May you be uplifted and praised. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, let's stand as we have our call to worship. Our call to worship is taken from Psalms 57, verses 9 through 11. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Let's join together as we sing, to God be the glory.
Father, we thank you for this day, for our time, for our fellowship, for each and every one who is here. I thank you for the opportunity to be here as well. And Lord, we just pray as we worship today that we might do this in a way that is pleasing to you, that ultimately you might be glorified, that as we hear the word preached, as we sing songs, as we fellowship, as we pray, as we do all of these different elements of worship together, that Father, we might be encouraged by it, that we might be rebuked by it, whatever it is, Lord, that your spirit might work in us to do that which is pleasing in your sight. So be with us now for those who are leading worship, for those who are here together, for the elders and the deacons and all gathered, Father, for me, that we might indeed go about this day and leave saying that it was good to be in the house of God today. And we pray all of this in Christ's name. Amen.
I forgot to say it was good to have Clint and his family here this morning. Y'all are kind of like family anyhow. It's kind of like, you know, it's like your friends that you don't get to see very often. And as soon as you see them, it's just like you was with them before. And that's a wonderful, wonderful thing. It is. We take time each week to come before the Lord with a confession of our sins. And it's to recognize where we have failed God in a lot of ways. But it's also to recognize that there's forgiveness. It's a deep, rich forgiveness. In our kids' lesson this morning, we had the story of where the lady come to Jesus and was offering her sacrifice of washing his feet with her hair. And how the Pharisees were looking at him and go, how can you get near a lady like this? And then he told the parable. There was a guy that owed a person $50, and there was a guy that owed a person $500. And they come before him, and he said, I can't pay it. And he forgave them both. And he said, which one do you think would be more grateful, the one that was given $500 or the one that was forgiven $50? And the thing is, they both needed the same thing. They needed forgiveness. The value was the great in both needs. And that's the way it is with us. The value is great for all of us this morning. So let's confess before the Lord this morning. Lord Jesus, I have sinned times without number and been guilty of pride and unbelief and of neglect to seek you in my daily life. My sins and shortcomings present me with a list of accusations, but I thank you that they will not stand against me, for all have been laid on Christ. Deliver me from every evil habit, every interest of former sins, everything that dims the brightness of your grace in me, everything that prevents me from taking delight in you. Amen. Let's pray to the Lord who offers that forgiveness. Let's ask the Lord for forgiveness in silent prayer. Our assurance of forgiveness is found in 1 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. At this time we'll have our offering.
Let's bow for offertory prayer. How great you are, Father, and thank you for this day that we can come together and worship as a body. Lord, we are thankful as we come to this part of our service. We are thankful for employment and for the means to give. Lord, I pray that we can just use these gifts to further your kingdom. In your name I pray. Amen.
Each week we take a moment to exercise what we believe in the Apostles' Creed. Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Let's stand as we sing.
Still, and know that he is God. What a perfect song as we enter into our time of pastoral prayer this morning, to be still and know that He is God. Again, I'm not the pastor here. I'm simply an elder that serves at Walnut Hill, but we have this time each week in pastoral prayer to pray for the needs of our congregation, to pray for God to work in us. And we just pray that you will join with us. And so we pray how God taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Father, we do come before you this morning, and we come before you and know that you are God. We come before you knowing that in the good times, in the bad times, in the difficult times, in the times we celebrate, in all things, you are God. You're sovereign, you rule, and you do things for our good. Sometimes we don't understand and we don't see that. But one day it'll be made clear to us, your plans, and we praise you and thank you for your work in each of our lives today. Lord, we thank you most of all that you sent a Savior for each of us here. And we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived a perfect life on this earth, was crucified, died, was buried. But God, that was not enough. As Paul said, Lord, what matters is the resurrection. And we praise you for Jesus rising from the dead to defeat sin and death, to give us all hope. And we thank you for that hope, that we can live with that as our light forward, the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Lord, our hearts are heavy as we look around the world today at what's happening. We see innocent people being slaughtered. We see babies getting their heads cut off and videotaped and placed out onto social media. We see innocent blood being spilt. And Father, we just pray, God, that you would intervene, that you would bring peace. Because, Lord, we need you here to help heal and bring the shalom peace that we all seek Father, we pray your will be done on earth, here, as it is in heaven. And Lord, we just pray that you would take each of us and make us instruments of your peace. Even though we may not be overseas, we each have our own mission field that you've given us. And we pray that we would be instruments of peace, hope, and love to those around us. Father, we need you as we prepare to worship, and we pray that you will drive your word deep in our hearts, that we will remember and we will act upon it. For we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Now, as our custom here at Walnut Hill, we like to pray for us as a congregation, and then we also like to have someone pray for our speaker, Clint. Carl, would you pray for us as a congregation, please? And I'm looking. Frankie Phillips, would you pray for our speaker here today, please?
Again, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to come together to worship you. We ask for your presence this morning to be with a church, with each individual, to open our hearts, open our minds to the speaker. Be with Clint as he speaks to us and just deliver the word to us that we're all here to absorb, make sure that we are receiving of that word. In Jesus' name.
Praise Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Lord. We just thank you that you brought Clint to us today, Lord. Just open our ears and our heart to hear the word today, Lord. Just let him speak the words that you want him to speak to us, Lord. And be with each and every one of us here today.
Clint, it's good to have you and your family here with us today. We've been privileged to watch your family grow through the years, to see you when you first got married, to see the children arrive, and now to see them almost grown up. And it's hard to believe, but we enjoy each and every time you come to be with us here at Walnut Hill, and we welcome you.
Oh, that was a good start. Hold on. I'll get pulled right down behind the pulpit, and I'll disappear. Oh, there we go. Well, it's always good to be here with you all and to see everybody. And really, it's kind of fun for me because I get to see a few people kind of grow up as well over the years. And I see all these babies now, all these little ones running around. I love that. I love hearing them. You know, it's actually one of my favorite things in worship. Sometimes you'll get that unexpected amen or something, and that voice is so small, you're wondering, where in the world did that come from, you know? But there it was. So it's good to be here, and you know, I've had a chance, and I'm grateful for this, to be here a few times in the past year, and I love that. I love seeing everybody here and getting to worship, and I'm glad Andy's able to, you know, go out and have a little bit of time and just take some time, and thank you for the privilege of always being able to come out and be with you all. Speaking of growing up, my children now are 15, 12, and 9. And Tristan had just recently passed at least the portion of the driving test with the written portion. And you know, he did all the studying. And as he was studying, he was asking me questions. And I was like, I don't know the answer to these questions. And so he took this test, and he ended up getting 28 out of 30 right. And I told him, I said, well, it's official that now you know more about driving than I do. So even though I've been doing it for a while. But yeah, everybody's getting older, and it's fun to see them get older. And, you know, it's fun when they're little, but it's fun when they get older, too, because you get to see that, I don't know, the personality just continues to grow, and it changes, and that's a beautiful thing. So good to be here again. Today, we're going to be speaking from a portion of Scripture, and it's interesting because as I was putting together a sermon, I was not studying these verses. Earlier on in the week, actually, Katie had reached out to me, and she said, hey, do you know what you're going to be speaking on? And she was right on it, and she asked me, and I thought I did, but at the moment she asked me, I said, you know what, I really don't. I'm sorry. I'm just going to have to think about it. And I said, I think I do, but I'm not sure. I'll get back with you. Well, then, something happened. So I'm in the car, and I'm flipping through the stations, right? And I'm going through XM radio. Now, XM, you know, I've got, like, the 70s and 80s hits, you know, 90s. So I've got all these great, the Beatles channel. I've got all these great things at my fingertips. So I immediately go to the Olsteen channel instead. You know, I go there. And because I'm like, I just, every now and then I'm flipping through, and I land on Olsteen's channel. Now, anyway, we'll stop right there. We'll just move on. But I stopped and I was listening to him. Now, I wish I got, now I'll say this. I wish I could get the inflections right when I to talk like that. Because he can really nail those inflections. I'm going to try maybe a little bit later on to get these right. But immediately he starts speaking. I stop and I'm like, all right, I'll stop. And we'll see. And he starts speaking. He's saying, you know, what if the world, instead of us always finding a way to tear each other down, what if instead we found a way to try to build each other up? And I thought, okay, all right. So then he begins to preach a little bit. And I didn't get to listen but to a few minutes of it on the way to church. But I got to tell you this. Regardless of what you may think, and trust me, I have a few thoughts as well. I've got some thoughts. We won't get into that. I found myself strangely encouraged by some of the things that he had to say in this moment, because it struck me that I have never preached on the subject purely on this. I'm sure it's come up, but I've never preached on the subject of encouraging, just building each other up purely on that. And it was a bit convicting, to be quite honest with you. And then I went and I started to study different scriptures, and I was shocked at how many verses specifically have to do with saying the right thing at the right time in order to encourage and build each other up and strengthen each other's faith. It was verse after verse after verse, and I thought, how have I not spoken about this? So anyway, Olsteen may or may not have been my inspiration for my sermon today. And wherever Andy is on vacation right now, I'm sure he's on his way back to stop me. And that'll be fine too. But if you could turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4, this might be a good place to start. Ephesians chapter 4. And we're going to begin, it's up here too. And we're going to begin reading in verse 25. Ephesians 4, verse 25, it says, therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor. For we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God and Christ forgave you. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer once more and ask the Lord's blessing upon the reading and hearing of his word. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here, that we're able to gather, we're able to worship for each and every one who is here. And may we, together as the body of Christ, may we glorify you, as was prayed earlier a couple of times, Lord. And Father, be with me as I speak, that I would indeed speak in spirit and in truth, and that we would all have ears to hear what you have for us today. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So, have you ever been around someone who is just a downer, right? You know the person, you're around them, and it doesn't matter what's going on, it's bad. It's bad, and they don't just believe it themselves, they want you to believe it. And so they tell you, And it doesn't matter what happens, what the situation is, there is almost no good word that proceeds from the mouth of this individual. Now, I'm not going to name any names here, especially. You'll throw something at me. And I don't really think that about anybody here that I know of. But you all know someone, I guarantee it, because we all have, maybe it's a family member, maybe it's a friend, maybe it's a church member, I hope not. Maybe it's a boss, co-worker, whatever. But there's nothing encouraging that ever comes from this person. All they do, it seems, is continuously bear down. And just to be around them makes you just feel a weight, right? You dread being around this individual because nothing good is going to come from it. But on the opposite side, we all know people in our life that we love to be around, right? You just love it. You think, oh, I'm going to go visit so-and-so. I love so-and-so. I like being around them. They always tell me I'm good-looking, and I like that. They always say, wow, you look better than last time I saw you. That was 15 years ago. But you love to be around them because they're an encourager. Because what they have to say is good. Now, I'm not talking about, and we'll get into this, I'm not talking about overly flattering anything. I just mean when they speak, they've got that smile, right? Maybe they have that too. And it's just a good thing when you're around them. And it's great, and it makes you feel good, and then you kind of want to be that person, right? You kind of want to encourage somebody. But that's the beauty of this. That's the beauty of helping each other. That's the beauty of building each other up, is that it's contagious. Just like the downer person can be contagious, and you kind of go home, and your spouse asks you, how was your day? Wasn't that great? You saw so-and-so again, didn't you? Yeah, I saw him. But that's how it is. But there are people in my life over the years where when I see them, it's immediately encouraging. And they take your hand and they shake it or they hug you. How are you doing? How are you? How's the family? You know, is everything good? How can I pray for you? These kinds of moments are a wonderful thing. And I've realized over time that I like that in my life, so maybe I should try to be that to somebody else. But let's look at this together. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 25. Now, it's funny we're beginning at verse 25 because it begins with therefore. Right? You don't normally start a conversation like that, right? So you call somebody, they answer the phone, and you answer the phone and go, so anyway. You know, that's not the way you start a conversation, but that's how we're going to start it today with this. Therefore, we're already in the middle of it, people. Therefore, put away lying. Put away lying, and let each of you speak truth with his neighbor. For we are members of one another, and this is what is so important about this, people. It was mentioned earlier, and I love this, that when I'm here, it's almost like I'm a part of the family. I love it. I love that because I feel the same way. And there really are friends and family in your life that maybe you don't see for a long time. And when you pick up, immediately you feel like you never left. Immediately, just like it was mentioned before. I was with a friend. I was at a wedding. Actually, last year, one of my cousins got married. And a friend of mine was in. He was from Seattle. And he used to live here locally, but he doesn't live here anymore. And I hadn't seen him in at least a year or more. And it was like we never left each other. Immediately, we just began a conversation with, all right, so let's just do this, right? We're in this together. Let's go. He's getting married, and we're all a part of this. And, you know, we got to spend 2 or 3 days together over the course of the next few days. It was awesome. We just picked right up. We even commented on it. We said, you know, we don't spend time catching up because we never left. And that is such a great thing. So here it is. Let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. We're all part of the body of Christ. When I have had a chance to worship overseas, even far away from here in the Southland that I love to worship here with everybody, you have that camaraderie, you feel like you belong. I've been and worshiped in other cultures, other countries, and immediately, even if you felt outside that culture, being there, when you're worshiping together, suddenly everything just clicks. Just clicks. Everything comes together. I'm worshiping in Africa with everything clicks. Here we are. We're together. We're in one place doing one thing. We're worshiping God. And it all feels so familiar. So this is it. We are members one of another. And be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. So this is what I would like to speak about this morning. And we see this all the time. You probably see this in your life. I've seen it in mine. Especially, let's think about it as a father. You fathers in the room. I've had a chance to be a father now for some years. My own father, and you know him. Now, my father was an encourager. He was. You know, growing up, he was the kind of guy that if I did something well, he would encourage me. Of course, if I didn't do something well, I would feel it for about the next hour or so. And that was good, too. But he was an encourager. Because he was something in my life where someone in my life, and my mother was too, where as I learned, as I grew, he would show me that he noticed that. He would show me this. And beyond that too, what my father would do was when I was young, everything was like, good job, all right. And with my children, I'm the same way. You know, they're young and they're picking up and they're getting used to doing things for you with young children, right? Has your son or daughter ever drawn you a picture, right? They've drawn you a picture, and it's like, you know, and they're spending like an hour on it. You know, they're just like, and they look at you with this look of determination, and you're like, this has got to be serious. And then they hold it up, and they're like, hey, Mom, Dad, look. And you're like, what is that? You know? And what if you had that attitude? What if you were like, son, what is this? Well, that's you, Dad. Can't you tell? Right there. Now, what if you've got two choices here, right? Two choices. You could either be like, wow, this is great. You're learning so good. Now, if they're like, you know, 20 years old or something and they've been doing it, you might say like, well, son, you could probably do better than that. But we're talking about real little, right? We're talking about they're still learning how to walk and they're just learning how to, you know, and they're still learning how to draw on the lines, right? Color on the lines. You're going to tell that kid, wow, that's awesome. It looks just like me, right? And you know what? You're not lying. It's not a lie to say that they're doing great, because that's where they are right now. They're young. They're little. They're learning how to do this. So that's where they are. So for you to tell them that, that is 100% correct. Good job. Well done. You watch them begin to walk, right? They're picking up, and you encourage them. What if you were the parent who, the moment they started to walk, you were never encouraging and you never did anything to help them? No matter what they did, it was never good enough. No matter how they progressed, you never showed them any appreciation, any gratitude whatsoever. How do you think the life of that child would be? How do you think the life, do you think that they would grow up strong, feeling good about their accomplishments, feeling right about where they are in their life? Or do you think that that may be holding them back? That you notice maybe they don't progress as well? And maybe other people notice this too. Maybe they aren't really accomplishing things. Maybe they start to do something and you're not encouraging of it. In fact, you may even put it down and suddenly they stop doing that thing. What if they had kept with it? What if they had kept going? Continued on. You know, when my son was young, my oldest son, I guess they're, you know, none of them are young now, but when my oldest son was young, we bought him a set of drums. All right, now if you never played the drums, right, there are two ways to play drums. One is good. And the other way is not as good. And so he sits down, and he's just... And I tell him, I was like, just go for it. Just go for it. So he's, you know, and nothing. I mean, nothing is, it's like, it's all over the place. You know, and as soon as you find the cymbals, it's over. It's just like, and you hear that for like 20 minutes straight. But you know what? After a while, though, that chaos begins to turn into a rhythm. But what if in the chaos I was like, stop, stop, never again? And that was it. That was it. And you stopped them right then and there. What if they kept going? What if they pushed on through the chaos? And what if suddenly they're playing just fine? And they're moving along. And that person that you didn't squash as they began with something in their life, instead you lifted them up and you said, all right, okay, let's see where you can go with this. But let's take this another step, though. That's easy to do with kids, right? Right? Because kids are a great example. Now, husbands, let's talk about y'all with your wives. All right? What kind of a person are you when it comes to those, the closest neighbor you have, right? God's commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. You're not going to get a closer neighbor than your family, right? It starts there. It starts in the home. So husbands, how's it going? Your wife, who I know, if she's anything like my wife and she does all these things for you all the time, what if I got home or was around her and I never, ever showed any appreciation for that? What if, you know, it's like that thing where suddenly one day I came home and I realized the dishes were not magic. It wasn't like the Fantasia movie, right, where Mickey puts on the hat and he starts to direct them and the dishes are dunking down and they're being washed and suddenly they just get put over there by magic. I come home one day and I see my wife doing the dishes. I'm like, what are you doing? Just let the magic do it, honey. No, that's not how it works. She was the one doing it. That's why they disappear from there and they go back in the cupboard. That's what happens. Or wives, do you show appreciation to your husbands when we do certain things, an accomplishment? How do we love each other? How do we encourage each other? Do you show that to one another? It's real easy when they're a kid because, you know, they're all cute and you want to be there for them. But, you know, sometimes as grown-ups, believe it or not, we can get on each other's nerves. But we push through that and we move on. Let's keep reading here. Let him who stole steal no longer, and rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. I love that. Let one who was doing one thing flip it on its head, and now the one who would steal is rather the one who was giving. That is such a wonderful thing. And listen to this. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Ouch. How many corrupt words have you let out of your mouth? How many corrupt words have I let out of my mouth? I can tell you right now, there are entire conversations that I wish I could take back. Have you been there? Entire conversations I wish I could take back. And I can't. I can't. I can try to make up for them now if I need to, but I can't take them back. That moment where I lashed out really angrily at my kids, and I get it. Sometimes you need to be like, whoa, stop. But sometimes it goes further than that, and you just lash out. Should I have thought about that more before I spoke? Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Turn with me, if you would, just seeing other examples of this in the Bible. A great place to go to find examples of proper speech is Proverbs. Proverbs, and we're going to begin in chapter 15, but you're going to find verses like this all throughout Proverbs. And this is where I said I was blown away at the idea of what it would be like to be an encourager instead of one who tears down. Proverbs 15, let's just start in verse 1. What turns away wrath? Read it. What turns away wrath? A soft answer. How often have you seen a situation escalate because a soft answer was not given? And instead, what we try to do is we see if we can match the pitch of the person speaking and then take it to the next level. And then suddenly, it raises and it raises and it raises and it's shouting. And all of it just escalates. But wait, what if instead you gave a soft answer and a harsh word stirs up anger, but a soft answer turns away wrath? And look at this, verse 2, the tongue of the wise uses knowledge rightly, but the mouth of fools pours forth what?
Foolishness.
What is in a man will come out of a man. That's why this is so easy for us not to be good, because by nature, we are not. By nature, we are not good people. We are born sinners. It is way easier for me to tear you down than lift you up. But that is not what we are called to do to one another in the body of Christ. We're called to try to be there and lift each other up. Verse 4. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks the spirit. If you want to break someone's spirit, just throw something at them just for the heck of it and see what happens with your words. It's not necessary. You can be a tree of life to that person, or you can break their spirit. Bless you. Yes. And so we'll move on now here in this, let's see, verse, oh goodness, I had a lot of these written down, but then I realized that my notes were different than the other ones that I put down. Verse 23, a man has joy by the answer of his mouth. And a this was almost the one that I spoke from this morning as my main passage. A man has joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season, how good it is. People of God, we should look for opportunities. Look for opportunities to show each other kindness. We should look for opportunities to be there for each other, to encourage each other. What if you were the boss, right? And you had, and this gets difficult, by the way, and you had people underneath you working, or even just a co-worker. Let's just say you were a co-worker, right? And this co-worker was constantly doing something wrong. They weren't really good. Of course, you may fire that person. I understand that at some point. But what if this person was struggling? They didn't really know how they were doing it. And instead of trying to show them and walk them through this, you just sort of berate them. They're never going to get it. They're not going to get it. It's no different than when you're dealing with family. A word in due season, how good it is. And what this shows is that there is a time and a season for everything, just as Ecclesiastes tells us. And so we don't have to look too far. That season will come to us. And there are times, right, where you thought, I almost said something in that moment. I almost said something. What was it? Was it you almost said something that could have been derogatory, or you almost said something that could have been encouraging? Which one would have helped that situation more? How does wisdom define this? I remember a man my father had great respect for, and still does. He's passed away now, but great respect for his teaching. This man was Dr. Francis Nigel Lee. And any of y'all who don't know about Dr. Francis Nigel Lee, fascinating guy. This is one of those guys, right, where you look at his life and you're thinking, is this guy an overachiever? I think he had 3 or 4 different doctorates behind him. And he had written all these different books. And he was this great speaker. And Dad was always talking about Dr. Francis Nigel Lee. Well, I had a chance to meet him one time when I was younger. Okay? And I had heard all this about him for all these years. And I was really excited. I actually chased him down. He was speaking at a conference, and my dad wasn't with me in that moment. I think he was off somewhere else. And he was walking down a staircase away from me. He was kind of leaving, and I ran after him. I said, Dr. Lee. And he looked back, you know, he just kind of looked up, and I said, listen, I really enjoyed what you had to say today. And he goes, oh, thanks. And he kept walking. And then I said, I'm one of the sons of Dr. Phil Blevins. And he stops. And he goes,
oh. And then he turns around and he walks back up those stairs, right? And he comes up to me and he puts his arm around me and he hugs me and he says this, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And then he turned around and he walked away. And I never forgot that. And it wasn't just because it was someone that Dad respected. That helped. Because I respect my father, so this guy. But because he took the time, the moment, to come to me and say these words to me. And even throw his arm around me. And that meant something to me. It was a word in due season. And how good it was. So, for each and every one of you, before I go off on, you know, I don't want to berate people too hard. I'm not calling out any names. I'm not pointing any fingers, because trust me, I could point the finger at myself as much as anybody else in this room, I'm sure more. But I am going to go off on a bit of a rabbit trail here, because I like rabbit trails. You know, they can lead to fun places sometimes if you don't get caught in the briars too much when you're going through them. But when we think about a word, right? The power of a word, right? That old lie that sticks and stones will break your bones, but what will never hurt you? Words? That is not true. Words can absolutely hurt. And what's different than bruises is that bruises will often eventually go away, but a word spoken not in due season, out of season, at the wrong time, that can stay in your mind for a long, long. It doesn't heal the way other things do. And I'll sit up, if you're anything like me, I'm about ready to go to bed at night, and I'm all tucked in, I'm feeling good, and then I think about that stupid thing I said 10 years ago to that person, and it keeps me up for the rest of the night. Be cautious with your words. Words can even define a man's fate. If a man is on trial, your words can define a man's fate. Everything. Words can build up a nation. Words can tear down a nation. Words have power. But not just your words have power. God's words have power. And when we think about the power that God's word has, and we think about a word spoken well in due season, we have examples of what to say oftentimes here. And we need to utilize those words. Because these are the words of life. And I'm going to take it a step further. One of the descriptions given about who God is himself is he is the good what? Word. That he is the word. John 1 tells us that in the beginning was the word. And it was with God, and it was God. God himself, word. All things around you, all of creation was begun by what? A word. Spoken. Didn't even have to use his hands to build. He spoke everything into being. And that is the power of a word. That it has the ability to create. It has the ability to give life. But it also has the ability to destroy life. So think about your own life. Think about how you use your words. Now here's a few things that I'm not telling you to do, by the way. Before you leave thinking, I'm just going to go and I'm just going to start throwing those compliments. Okay, so... unless it's about my preaching today, then you can say anything you want. But one thing I am not encouraging you to do before we leave today, don't lie. Okay? Don't lie. Because lying doesn't really benefit. Now, okay, let me stop. I won't go too far down that road. Saying that maybe being misleading is not always the answer, we won't get into that. There are weird cases in the Bible where, you know, like the midwives who lied and told Pharaoh, oh yeah, we just couldn't make it in time, and the babies, they were born, we just, They lied, but God bless that. I'm not talking, that's one of those weird moments. But normally lying is not a good thing, okay? Normally lying is absolutely something we are not supposed to do. There are rules against this, right? There are commandments against this. Don't lie. If somebody's doing something they shouldn't do, don't think, all right, well, I'm just going to lie and compliment them anyway. Be cautious about that. Because if you're complimenting when you shouldn't compliment, that can also be destructive. So watch out. But the other thing you should do is don't be this overly flattering personality. Because believe it or not, that's also lying. You know, if something really isn't good, you don't have to say that it is. Maybe you can find some way to approach it where the words aren't quite as harsh. That may be wisdom. But you don't have to lie. You know, if somebody brings you this meal and you're tasting it and they're like, isn't that good? And you're like, oh, yeah, it is. It's wonderful. And it is just terrible, right? You don't have to just spit it right out and just say, this is the dumbest thing I've ever put in my mouth. But, you know, you could find a better way to say it, maybe. I don't know. But don't lie, because that doesn't benefit. Don't be overly flattery, because that's another form of deceit, right? But also, you don't have to look for opportunity. Opportunity will present itself for you to be an encourager. For you to be an encourager, just don't pass up the opportunities. Don't pass them up. You don't have to go out of your way. You don't have to try to run after somebody to make sure you complimented their shoes today or something. But when the opportunity comes up, think about what it might mean to take that opportunity. Because maybe you're quiet, maybe you decide not to say it. How would that have changed that person's day or that person's life? You know, if Dr. Lee that day had just said thank you and walked on, that would have been fine. Wouldn't have been anything wrong. But when he took that moment to turn around and come back and show me a specific appreciation, a specific attention, and to speak words to me like that, that was such an encouraging thing. And I never forgot it. And if he had just said thanks and moved on, I might not have thought that differently about him. I might have thought, oh, okay. But how much more it meant that he took that opportunity. So people in your life, husbands, wives, and by the way, if you're always waiting on them to compliment you first in order for you to compliment them back, I got news, that's not really always the way it works. Sometimes my wife compliments me, and I realize maybe I haven't said anything really nice today or not. And sometimes it takes you to initiate. It takes you to initiate something in order for it to reciprocate, and then it spreads. But don't pass up opportunity to be an encourager to one another. Even if it's just a passing word, you have no idea how that word could be the season that was good for that person. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for your words. Thank you that you are the word. And Lord, I just pray that we would go out today and be, I hope, encouraged by this, that we wouldn't feel like, oh my goodness, I've just failed. If even if we have, Lord, in you there is forgiveness. And Father, at the end of these verses that we studied today, it says this, and I will read it again in this prayer. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Father, if you can forgive us, certainly we can forgive each other. And Father, the world is going to act how it's going to act, because they're outside of you. But Father, if we as the body of Christ could learn how to be there for one another, how to encourage one another, how to stir one another up for love and good works, what a change we would see in this world. So help us to do that, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Stand as we sing. Jesus paid it all.
Father, thank you again for your words. And now as we go out, help us to live with you as our example. And may we show others the love of Christ, the mercy of God, even, Father, the judgment that awaits for those who don't hear your words. Father, help us to be what we need to be for those around us, that ultimately you may be glorified. And may we do this all for the love of Christ. And we pray in his name. Amen.